What's good, YouTubers and YouTubettes? This is JB Sports back again with another one. Three division world champion Gervonta Tank Davis is looking to get back into the square circle at the end of 2021. Now, after his last fight, when he stopped regular WBA junior welterweight champion Mario Barrios, he said he will be coming back in October. Now, due to a lot of fights being lined up in the month of October, and probably the biggest fight of 2021 taking place in the first week of November, I think it's going to be tough for Gervonta Tank Davis to fight in October. I think the more likely scenario is for him to fight in late November or early December. We will see what happens, and we will see what transpires. Now, Keith One Time Thurman, former unified welterweight champion, has been mentioned as a possible opponent for Gervonta Tank Davis. Nah, don't see it. Don't see it. I don't see the numbers working out for that fight. Basically, Keith One Time Thurman, what he made when he fought Manny Pacquiao, he made $2.5 million guaranteed minimum. And then I think he went home with around $5 million when it was all said and done. You know, he got back-end money for that fight. As all Al Heyman fighters do, they get back-end money. What you see in print, you know how they say read the fine print? Yeah, read the fine print, but that's not the end-all, be-all. They get money from different revenue streams involving their fights, so that's not what they actually making. But with that being said, he made $2.5 million guaranteed minimum for a Pacquiao fight that sold 600,000 pay-per-view buys. So he's been part of a more successful pay-per-view than Gervonta Tank Davis, you know. So he would have to willing to be, you know, he would have to accept lower guaranteed minimum. You look at Leo Santa Cruz, who, I don't think y'all know this, he was an A-side in that Gervonta Tank Davis fight because he made more money. He made $1.5 million guaranteed minimum, and Gervonta Tank Davis made $1 million guaranteed minimum. Both fighters, again, being Al Heyman fighters, made more than that, but when at the end of the day, Leo Santa Cruz walked away with a bigger check than Gervonta Tank Davis. Now, his second fight on pay-per-view, he was the clear A-side, as he made more money than Mario Barrios. I think he made, that being Davis, I think he made around $1.5 million guaranteed minimum, and Mario Barrios made around, I think it was $500,000 to $750,000. I can't remember, but it was somewhere in there. It was definitely way under $1 million. When it was all said and done, I think Mario Barrios probably walked away with about 1.5. And I think when it was all said and done, Gervonta Tank Davis walked away with around somewhere between 3 and 5 million. With that being said, I don't think the number is going to work because, like I said, Gervonta Tank Davis is not going to accept less because he feels he's at A-side status. So he's going to want a particular set amount of money. And Keith One Time Thurman, due to his last pay-per-view fight, is going to want a set amount of money. And I don't think the number's going to work, man. They're going to have to really sell the hell out of that fight. That fight's going to have to do somewhere around, you know, at least $500,000 pay-per-view buys to satisfy both fighters and for Al Heyman and the PBC to show a profit. So I don't see that fight happening. Long story being short, I don't see the numbers working out for that fight. Number two, I don't think Leonard Ellis be fancy that fight, despite what he said on Twitter. Talking about he will make that fight in a nanosecond. And to this day, Keith One Time Thurman ain't seen no contract. So, actions speak louder than words, basically what I'm saying. You can talk about a whole lot of things on your Twitter. But until you send the man a contract, a version of a contract, or what you call that, a draft of a contract, term sheets, I think that's what they call it in boxing, term sheet. Then we ain't talking, we ain't doing nothing but doing a lot of talking. That's what Keith One Time Thurman was saying. He was trying to tell Leonard Ellis, man, don't play me. Don't play me, man. What you doing is real fugazi right now. You know, you putting a lot of, you know, smoking mirrors. You capping. You ain't trying to make that fight. We up under the same platform. We both up under the PBC. I don't have a fight. I ain't fought since the Pacquiao fight. I'm looking for a big fight. I done several interviews telling you that I don't just want to get back and fight some nondescript fight. What's going to get my blood boiling? What's going to get me up early in the morning for them early morning jogs? What's going to get my meter running? There's a big name fight, a big time fight, and Gervonta Tank Davis fits that bill. But that fight's not going to happen, ladies and gentlemen. Now they're talking about Raleigh. Oh, Raleigh. Rolando Raleigh. Romero, a.k.a. the self-proclaimed Roberto Duran. Hands of stone. I like how Raleigh fought, man. I like that fight. He fought on the undercard of the Jamal Charlo Montiel fight that took place in Toyota Center, H-Town, my town. And he was able to knock that guy out. I can't remember the guy's name, man, but you know, he just puts on a lot of antics, man. He don't have a lot of skill. I'm being kind. He's a guy that's basically looking to land one shot. He kind of like the Deontay Wilder of the lightweight division, man. He's just looking to land one shot. He's looking to land that right hand, man. But he's so persistent. He got so much confidence. You see how he be acting in between rounds, sitting on his stool. He just like, he can't wait for that bell to ring so he can get back out there and try to knock out his opponent, man. He does a lot of things wrong in the middle of the ring. You know, his skill level is not high. He makes a lot of mistakes, but he's got a lot of determination. He's got a lot of self-belief, and he's a great self-promoter. But that fight's not going to happen because both guys are fighting up on the Mayweather promotions, kind of like Anthony Joshua and Dillian White fighting up on the Matchroom Boxing. A lot of people have been looking for that fight to happen in the last 2 or 3 years. It's not going to happen anytime soon because Matchroom Boxing is making money off of Anthony Joshua fighting other fighters beside Dillian White. And they making money off Dillian White fighting other fighters besides Anthony Joshua. Why would they put them two guys facing off against each other and then one win and the other one have to take a step back after that fight to rebuild themselves? You know what I'm saying? And then their next fight probably wouldn't be worth as much as they made in the fight involving fighting each other. So I don't think that would be something that Matchroom Boxing is looking to do anytime soon. Now, I know a lot of people say, wait a minute, JB Sports, didn't Eddie Hearn offer Dillian White the Anthony Joshua fight when Big Baby, fell not one, not two, not three, not four, but he failed multiple PED tests, and that was, I don't know if that was the first or second one he failed, and he got pulled from that fight. Then they offer Dillian White the fight. Yeah, they gave him a low ball offer. They gave him an offer that they knew he wouldn't accept, so that was just something just to satisfy, make it look like they was trying to make the fight, but they had a plan all along that if it wasn't going to be Big Baby, it was going to be Andy Ruiz Jr., a.k.a. the Michelin Man. And we saw what happened that night when Anthony Joshua waved that white flag. Didn't want no part of Andy Ruiz once he got hurt and got dropped multiple times. Got beat from pillar to post. And he surrendered. But that's neither here nor there. It's not going to be rolling. Rolling on the river. Ain't gonna be no rolling. Ain't gonna be that fight. So, what's next? I hear about Mr. Gary Russell Jr. Don't seem like Leonard and old Floyd are too keen on making that fight. Basically, Russell done did everything but talk about them two guys' mama to try to get them to make the fight, and they don't want to make the fight. You know, don't want to make the fight. According to Gary Russell Jr., Floyd called him on the phone, told him to leave Gervonta Tank Davis alone. Quit messing with him. Quit throwing sand on in his face in the sandbox. Basically treating him like he was Gervonta Tank Davis' daddy. Calling Gary Russell, telling him to leave his little son alone, man. It sounded real bad if that was the case. But that fight's not going to happen. That'd be a good fight on the East Coast. Be a real good fight. But I think they still think at this point in time, Gary Russell Jr. is a little bit too in his prime and a little bit too dangerous. So they're going to leave that alone for right now. Maybe down the road when they see a little slippage in Gary Russell Jr., they'll look to make that fight. Kind of like when Floyd Mayweather eventually fought Sugar Shane Mosley when he saw slippage in him. So we will see what happens and we will see what transpires. But let me go to my guy that I think has a real good chance of being Gervonta Tank Davis's next opponent. And these two guys that had beef running for 4 years, gotten two altercations at fights that both fighters attended. And that is Gervonta Tank Davis versus Tevin Farmer. I don't know why nobody thought about this. This would be the perfect match to make happen either in late October or late November or early December. This would be the perfect match. Perfect matchup. These guys got real beef. Real beef. Got into each other's grill talking trash, going back and forth. The first time was about 4 years ago. I don't know where that was at. Some altercation. Almost seemed like they was in a mall or something. I don't know where they were. And Tevin Farmer was like, man, let's make it happen. Let's fight. Let's fight. And Gervonta was like, man, you ain't got no belt. You got 4 losses. You ain't got no power. You got 6 knockouts and 30 fights. Man, please. What you ain't bringing nothing to the table. They going to say I knocked out some little, you know, light hitting, pillow fisted, multiple loss fighter. I ain't going to get no credit for that. I'm fighting champions. So they went back and forth and, you know, Gervonta got mad because Tevin touched him and he started wanting to fight. He didn't want nobody to touch him. Don't touch me. Don't touch me. Don't touch me. Don't touch me. Until one of his homeboys had to grab him. That was the first altercation. So Tevin Farmer took heed to the words that were coming out of Gervonta Tank Davis saying, hey, you ain't got no belt. And he was able to beat Billy Dill, probably his best win of his career, for the vacant IBF super featherweight title. So in the Barclays Center, in another fight that both guys attended, here come Tevin. Tevin sees Gervonta, steps to Gervonta, say, yeah, now what? I got a belt. I'm the IBF super featherweight champion. Let's do this because I ain't new to this. What's up? What you want to do? What you going to do when Tevin Farmer brings the boxing skills on you? You know what I'm saying? And Gervonta came in with his phrase that he came with in the first altercation. Don't touch me. And then Gervonta said, when you fighting, man, on 20? When you fighting on the 20? And then Gervonta David just walked off, man. And I guess he felt he was getting upset again. He didn't want the altercation to happen. He was, you know, he was just trying to come enjoy the fight. So he walked away. And then I think Gervonta Tank Davis and his team was like, okay, let's make this fight. They tried to make this fight actually about 2 years ago. After he knocked out, I think it was Hugo Diaz, a highlight reel knockout. He hit that boy on the side of his ear and the side of his forehead. And like he had just, it was, all you saw was blood all dripping down the earlobe and the side of his ear and the side of his forehead. It was just a devastating knockout. You'd have thought he got hit upside his head with a goddamn sledgehammer, not a punch. And right after that fight, he said, look here, Tevin, let's make it happen. I know you fighting later on. I think they were fighting on the same night. I think Tevin Farmer was fighting some guy named Jonah Carroll, I think that was. Or maybe he was fighting that Frenchman. And, you know, Tevin Farmer do what Tevin Farmer do. He went there and outboxed the guy, but he didn't knock him out. Didn't drop him no time. But he out there put on a boxing clinic. You know, great head movement, you know, in that Philly shell defense and fighting a real good fight. He was able to coast his way to a unanimous decision win. But guess what Tevin Farmer did in the post-fight press conference? Tevin Farmer started acting brand new. Talking about, man, I'm the IBF champion. If he want to fight me, he need to come fight me on the zone. He need me more than I need him. You know, I started talking brand new like he was the face of boxing. But what Gervonta Tank Davis did, he said, okay, whatever. All right, whatever. I'm going to move around. I'll move on. And what him and his team did was brilliant. They went on to fight Leo Santa Cruz on Showtime pay-per-view and then went on to fight Mario Barrios on Showtime pay-per-view and became the face of boxing from 130 to 140 pounds. Now they are the clear A-side. Tevin Farmer ended up losing to JoJo Diaz. Ooh, yeah! Lately I had a strange feeling. Yeah, lost to old JoJo. You know, he got knocked out and stopped. He just got outboxed and outmaneuvered in that fight. He was blinking in that fight, like, he was blinking and stuff. I don't know what's wrong with him. I don't know if he got hit early in that fight and it just knocked his equilibrium off. He was just, you know, threw him off. Maybe he got hit in sparring, but he does not look right in that fight, man. Sergio Mora, he was talking about it in the fight. You know, the other commentators was talking about it. He did not look right, but that's neither here nor there. He lost the fight. So I know a lot of people gonna like, be saying like, why would Gervonta Tank Davis fight Tevin Farmer? Tevin Farmer lost to JoJo Diaz. But why the Floyd Mayweather Jr. fight Zab Judah when Zab Judah lost to Baldomir? Because it's a big fight, and guys had history. Those guys, when they were coming up in the ranks, were looked at as the top young fighters coming into the sport at that time. A lot of people thought Zab Judah was going to end up being better than Floyd Mayweather Jr. because Zab Judah had the power that Floyd Mayweather Jr. did not have. Floyd Mayweather Jr. had power early on in his career, but he didn't have power like Zab. Zab had one hit a quarter power. You see what he did to Corey Spinks. So a lot of people thought he was going to end up being better, but Floyd Mayweather Jr. was more dedicated to the sport, and Floyd Mayweather Jr. was more of a natural boxer, had more technical skills, and he went on to have a far better career, as we see as I'm standing here today. And as you standing here watching this video, you can see how both guys fought throughout their career. You're looking at Floyd Mayweather Jr., all-time great, no doubt Hall of Famer, and then you got Zab Judah, who's going to be in the Hall of Fame. If he's not, I don't know if he is he in the Hall of Fame? Somebody text me after this video. Is Zab Judah in the Hall of Fame? Or is he not eligible yet? You know, I don't know what the time frame. You got to be out, what, 3 to 5 years or somewhere in that frame? I know in the NFL, you got to be out away from the game 5 years to be eligible. So maybe he's not being eligible. I ain't even heard his name come up in Hall of Fame, nominations. But that's neither here nor there. He still had a great career. If he's not in the Hall of Fame, he should be in the Hall of Fame. Arturo Gatti is in the Hall of Fame. So if Arturo Gatti is in the Hall of Fame, Zab Judah damn sure should be in the Hall of Fame. But that's neither here nor there. That fight was done. And that fight did around 350,000 pay-per-view buys, if I'm not mistaken, the Floyd Mayweather Jr. Zab Judah fight. I mean, I went to a club, man, and they had that fight on in the club. Everybody was lit about that fight. So I think this fight could be like that fight on a smaller scale. Like I said, they got a four-year beef. They've been going back and forth with each other, even though Tevin Farmer is coming off a loss. Tevin Farmer is a free agent. He used to be with Lou DiBella Entertainment, but they have since parted ways. So, again, Floyd Mayweather Jr. say that they're going to be doing in-house fights with Gervonta Tank Davis. So I think what Tevin Farmer needs to do is he needs to sign with Al Haymon. And even if he loses to Gervonta Tank Davis, he'll still be in line to get other top fights in or in and around 140, 135, and 130 pounds. So we will see what happens, and we will see what transpires. What weight that fight takes place? Now, the WBA has came out a couple of days ago and said they're going to get rid of all these interim champions, and they're going to start trying to solidify each division and quit having so many belts. And I think that's going to be a good way to do that. Now, as we know, they're going to be trying to order a lot of mandatory fights. I think Gervonta Tank Davis probably has a mandatory coming up in the 130-pound weight class, because that's the the 135-pound. I think it's probably it's due to be called in the WBA first, and then I think after that it's the 130-pound and then 140-pound. With that being the case, if he can maybe bring Tevin Farmer up to 140-pound, because I don't think he's going to have a mandatory call at that because he just won the belt. And he can fight Tevin Farmer as a voluntary at 140 pounds. That could be a possible matchup between those two rivals. If not, then you could do it at 135 pounds. You get the mandatory guy. I think Ricky Gutierrez is the mandatory. I'm hearing that he could be in line to fight Chris Cobell in the winner of that fight, Gervonta Tank Davis. So you let those two guys fight. They give you time to possibly fight Tevin Farmer at 135 pounds. So I think Tank Davis's next fight will be at 135 pounds, 140 pounds. And Tevin Farmer out of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, will be a perfect opponent, in my opinion. They could put that fight on the East Coast. Maybe put that fight. Now, I haven't seen too many big fights on the East Coast yet due to this COVID-19 pretty much surging again. The Barclays hasn't hosted any fights, and I don't see any fights on the horizon at the Barclays or even at the MGM in the casino in Washington, D.C. So I don't know if that fight could be put on the East Coast. So they might have to take that fight down to the ATL, to Atlanta. And Gervonta Tank Davis' last fight there was against Mario Barrios. And that fight would take place in front of another star-studded crowd. It will be in attendance, just like the fight he fought last against Mario Barrios. So we will see what happens. We will see what transpires. Let me know your thoughts about Gervonta Tank Davis taking on Tevin Farmer Would you like to see those two guys match up? The trash talking would be epic. The press conference would be epic. And you know Gervonta Tank Davis would like nothing more than to knock out Tevin Farmer. As Tevin Farmer got into his face on two occasions when both guys attended fights, you know he's going to be looking to shut him up for good and get a highlight reel knockout. You know he's going to be looking to try to destroy Tevin Farmer. If he hurts him, you know he's going to go in for the kill. He's going to go in for the kill anyway, but you know he's going to really try to sleep Tevin Farmer. So if Tevin Farmer can maybe work that to his advantage, over-aggressive Gervonta Tank Davis, he can make him slip, dip, jab, stay out of harm's way, go into that Philly shell defense, use the jab, use his combinations, jab to the body, basically try to quail the onslaught that Gervonta Tank Davis is going to bring to him. So we will see what happens, and we will see what transpires. Let me know your thoughts about Gervonta Tank Davis possibly taking on Tevin Farmer in his next fight at the end of 2021. Hit the like button if you like the content of this video. And subscribe to JB Sports, the man, the myth, the legend. I holla.